Now, like I said last time, this video is a bit difficult to do because Apollo Justice takes place in the future, and the next few games move back to around the time the first trilogy of games took place. We do know that a handful of Apollo Justice characters show up later on, so let's go over the ones that don't first. I want to say that Christoph is a great villain. He certainly had a pretty great plan and nearly got away with seeing his enemies silenced, disbarred, or otherwise taken care of. He even had a pretty ingenious way of killing his enemies. We'd seen people poisoned an Ace Attorney before, but never in this way. And the conversations he had with Phoenix in his cell had a very Hannibal feel to them. But then there's the matter of his motivation, because he lost a card game and went fucking crazy. Dude, given that you could afford to bribe the jailer so you could turn your cell into your personal library, did you really need the money from one client who didn't like you as a person? And hey, way to justify that. If nothing else, though, he's admirable in just how insane he becomes. He goes ballistic once his plan falls apart, and seeing that calm demeanor shatter so completely is pretty damn awesome. As for his voice, well, it's hard to find someone who can play an evil genius well and then go completely crazy later on. And then, surprisingly enough, I thought of Aizen. Yeah, Aizen is a character I never thought I'd talk about in a positive light, but his voice is one of his few good points. I actually hadn't seen the final battle between him and Ichigo in English, so while researching for this video I looked it up, and when I compared his final breakdown with how Kyle played him normally, calm and collected, yeah, I think Kyle Hibera would be a good match for Christoph. Even just hearing him scream "Right!" in Aizen's voice would be suitably chilling to match this villain. Zack's actions are sort of difficult to justify for me. On the one hand, I can see why he pulled his vanishing act, but I can't see why he didn't drop in on Trucy or try to contact her in a way only she would know about. I mean, come on, as far as you knew, she was the only family you had left. Then again, to abandon her must have been even harder for him for that reason. And all of this for a murder that, in the end, wasn't even a murder. Luckily for him, though, Trucy does still have at least one living relative. And then you have the problem of why he hired Olga to begin with. Yeah, way to possibly cost your daughter's only supporter his job. And why? Because he was a sore loser? Seriously, it feels like those cases were written by different people. As for his voice, well, it's hard to say. He should be able to capture both powerful magician and loving father well. I'm thinking maybe James Earl Jones? There really isn't much to Olga as a character. She's just a professional card dealer in disguise as a stereotypical Russian waitress. So as such, I'll give her a stereotypically Russian voice. Kasusi gave Linka one in Captain Planet, and she could just drop the accent when she drops the disguise. I quite like Mr. Eldoon. He's a crotchety old man, but with quite a bit more character development than, say, Victor Kudo. I even like his noodle wig.
That's right. It's no good to have secrets. You'll always need someone to talk to about things. To tell the truth, there's something I've been worrying about, but listening to you talk has made me want to get the secret off my chest.
Wow, I never would have guessed that you had a secret like mine. I'd like to help you, if I can.
Oh, it's so nice to have someone to confide in. Well, here goes. I wear a wig. Well, when compared to your secret, I don't think that mine's really that big of a deal.
You're wrong. My secret's nothing compared to this bombshell.
I'd say, if anything, his problem is that we don't get that much of him. Eldoon's noodles does show up in Dual Destinies, but Mr. Eldoon himself does not. Which is a pity, because he has a decent backstory and is an entertaining character. In fact, he kind of reminds me of Crocus from One Piece. Humorous design and dialogue, but capable of being serious. So I think his voice actor, Burl Proctor, would do nicely. Plum is pretty hilarious as a character in terms of design and personality. I like Apollo's reactions to being intimidated by her. But deep down, it's evident that she has her son's best interest at heart, despite his attitude. And given how much attitude he has, that says a lot. They really do seem to be one big happy crime family. Former crime family. As for her voice, well, I've heard Colleen Klinkenbeard do deeper voice female characters in several series I've watched, And I think that would suit Little Plum just fine. Alita Teala is basically a low-rent version of Dahlia Hawthorne, and the sad part is her motivation makes more sense to me than Dahlia's did. Sure, she's a gold digger, but at least the good doctor did something to her that would make her want to commit murder, and she played Walkie for a fool, but to be fair, he is one. Phoenix at least got smarter later on. I think that her voice should be a clever play on the whole damsel in distress idea. I've seen Jennifer Hale play damsels in distress before, but she's good at subverting that idea. And Alita is kind of one when she shoots the doctor. That, and I just think her voice matches up well with her design. Like I said, though he looks intimidating as hell, even with the apron, Big Wins is really all about trying to get his son out of the gangster life so he can go straight and, you know, live. In that aspect, it's easy to sympathize with him. Plus, that eyebrow reveal is hilarious no matter how many times I see it. For this, you know, normally I'd say to hire someone who can do a good Robert De Niro impersonation, but for this one, bring out De Niro himself. He may be getting old, but he can still do that voice, and I think it's only fitting for this character. Plus, I'd like to hear him tell Apollo that he'll bake him a pie sometime. Capiche? Walkie at first comes off as pretty annoying, but like another wannabe gangsta in a DS game, he later demonstrates hidden depths to his character. Walkie is one of those stupid teenagers who wants to live the thug life without knowing just how terrible it can be. And he finds out the hard way. The clash between him and his father comes off as a clash between generations in more ways than one. The old gangster meeting the young gangsta. In a society that romanticizes the gang lifestyle, when in reality it's a lot less glamorous than it is in the movies. So it's hard to sympathize with him at first, but the possibly fatal injury and the girlfriend who was just using him the whole time helps. Being the filler case of the game, Turnabout Corner is sillier than the other cases by virtue of involving panties alone. But I really like the family dynamic the Kitakis had. As for his voice, this is gonna sound crazy, but Phil Lamar. I've heard him play characters of all races, guys. I know he can do it. This guy just... ugh. It says a lot about someone's character when you can like them less than the actual crazed murderers in the game, but everything about this character just disgusts me. Congratulations, Dahlia. I now have a character I hate more than you. If only for the fact that I could spend more than 5 minutes with you. With this guy, I wouldn't last 5 seconds before force-feeding him that stupid textbook. So as such, I really don't care about his voice. In fact, I'm glad we never see him again. Lemmy Roar's story is compelling, and it's one that I want closure on that, sadly, we haven't gotten as of this video. With the accident, she lost her memory and became an international singing sensation. Like you do. I don't know how she got to Borginia in the first place, but I guess Magnifique decided it was the best way to get away from the public eye. But when you hear her voice, you believe everything people say about her. She's charming and very likable despite the whole lying about being blind thing, which admittedly was the product of her publicist. But then again, what do you expect from the mother of Apollo and Trucy? For her voice, well, I've heard her sing, and I think that Greg Griffin now, would be a perfect match. Latouse really wasn't with us long enough to leave much of an impression. All we know was that he was an undercover Interpol agent and a really big man. So let's give him a guy who voiced a pretty big man with an accent fairly recently. J.B. Blanc, the voice of Wonder Yellow. Machi is a character I think I should like more than I do. I believe his devotion to Lamy Roar, and I believe that he's legitimately afraid to go home and be killed. But then there's the matter of his motivation. All we ever get was that the situation was bad and he needed the money. If he'd been trying to pay to get Lamy Roar's eyesight restored, that I could understand. But no, he just needed money badly. Which is fair enough, but I think he could have been a more sympathetic character. So let's try and give him a really talented voice actress to make up for that. Tara Strong. She's established that she can play young male characters pretty well, I think that she could differentiate his voice enough from, say, Timmy Turner's, and add an accent to keep with his character. Trucy's Uncle Valen is one of the more sympathetic villains in the series. From the beginning, he always felt like everything had been taken from him, to the point where he decided to seize his master's magic for himself, even if it meant implicating his partner. He might be less sympathetic because of that, but he decides to turn himself in at the end, so at least it's shown that he has a conscience. It really is too bad that he ended up like he did. For his voice, well, Valen is a very flamboyant character, being a showy stage magician and all, and yet there are moments where he's quiet and scheming, too. So, you know, I think we should have him be voiced by another great showman, Tim Curry. I'm just not sure how well he could pull off the Alakazong. Darien is definitely one of the less likable villains in the series. Exploiting a kid, a blind person, and the father of a kid dying of a fatal disease, it is really satisfying when he gets his in the end. Not to mention that breakdown. But oddly enough, whenever he talks, I keep picturing him with the voice of Axel from Kingdom Hearts 2, Quentin Flynn. Call me crazy, but I think the cocky-sounding voice would fit the character, too. But seriously, Japan, you can't tell me no one looked at that hairstyle and said, "That's a dick!" If you don't feel sympathetic for Vera by the end of this game, then you have no soul. And it's hard not to, because she got fucking used. Kristoff made her think that he was a kind-hearted guy with her best interests in mind while getting her to lose an innocent man his job and put another one in jail, and putting in ticking poison time bombs that would kill both her and her father just for knowing too much. I swear, if Vera had actually died, this would be one of the most depressing games ever made, right up there with Mother 3. And guess what? There's a way you can make that happen! If you say she's guilty, but frankly, why would you? Vera succumbs to the atroquinone poisoning and dies. Because this wasn't depressing enough! So you know what? Let's twist the knife in further and give her a really cute voice, courtesy of Hendon Walsh. Brushell's character kind of baffles me, to be honest. They expect us to take him as a serious part of the story since he was the only reporter who cared enough to dig up the truth about Troop Grammari and keep it a secret. He was one of only three people to keep the fact that Zack Grammari was alive a secret between them. And yet, they make him so stereotypically nerdy that it's almost impossible to take him seriously, even in situations where they clearly want you to. To pull off a character like this, we'd need a great voice actor. One of the legends capable of bringing heart to even the strangest of characters. Ladies and gentlemen, get me Rob Paulsen. Drew is another one of those characters we just didn't get to know that well, which I suppose is the point of him being a victim. He died before we got to know more about him. But what we do get to see of him is at least likable. He saw that Phoenix was a good person and was willing to make sacrifices to help other people, but he also loved his daughter and would do anything to keep her safe. He mentions that his wife didn't approve of his loner lifestyle and left them years earlier. Ouch. As for his voice, while this might sound strange considering I never watched the original TMNT show, but I've heard Peter Renaday's voice on Talkin' Toons. If you don't know, he was the original voice of Splinter. If he dropped the accent, I think Peter's voice would be pretty close to what I have in mind for Drew. And those are all the characters that only show up in this game. Again, as far as we know. There are a couple of characters that did show up here that I don't feel like talking about again. Winston Payne, Mike Meekins, Dr. Hickfield, and Detective Gumshoe. Mostly because the first three are pretty static characters and not worth mentioning, except for that one moment I talked about with Meekins, and Gumshoe wasn't around long enough for additional development. But we'll be seeing most of them again next time. But in addition, there won't be any voice recommendations for the recurring characters here. Mostly because they already have them. When the series moved to the 3DS in Dual Destinies, an important addition was made. Animated cutscenes. These gave the characters more personality in the form of voices outside of the various OBJECTIONS! The main reason I chose voices for the characters in previous games were because they didn't get the chance to have voices of their own thanks to being on a console with games that just couldn't hold all the voice clips. But once I heard their voices in English, I really don't have any complaints with them. I couldn't picture anyone else being the voice of Apollo or Trucy or Clavier than the cast they decided on. Also, fun fact, Apollo's voice actor, Orion Acaba, is also the voice of Crazy Dave in Plants vs. Zombies. So, TLDR, I won't be talking about the voice actors for these characters because they have them already. The biggest complaint I hear people say about Apollo is that he's a carbon copy of Phoenix. One, that's not entirely true, and two, the fact that he's like Phoenix is kind of the point. Specifically, he has an attitude similar to the young Greenhorn Phoenix once was. He always feels like he's in over his head, but he still wants to help people and do the right thing. And are those such bad qualities to have in a hero? A big part of this game is that Phoenix feels like he should pass the torch to Apollo because maybe his time in the spotlight is over. He digs at him a lot, but you get the feeling that he does actually care for him. And his talent doesn't feel like it's copying the Magatama, especially because he can use perception during testimony. It's magic, sure, but observing when a person is lying can be done with training in the real world. All in all, I feel like if you wanted to make Apollo the new hero of the series, you could do a lot worse. Another big complaint is that Phoenix's personality here clashes with his personality in the rest of the series. People aren't used to seeing this side of Phoenix, as a chess master that planned to trap Christoph to the point of getting an entirely new justice system started. But really, I think it makes sense. Hear me out. Phoenix got dealt a very bad hand when Christoph set him up as he did. From there, he had nothing to do after he lost his job, but wonder just what went wrong in following that to plan. He got to see firsthand just how flawed the Japanifornian justice system is, and he knew that because of that, multiple innocent people got hurt. Now, why he still had enough clout to be directly involved in the jurist system getting started is a mystery to me, but it may have had something to do with the connections Phoenix had in the prosecutor's office. But we'll get to that later. The biggest problem with Phoenix's portrayal here actually isn't in this game, but the next one chronologically, Dual Destinies, which I'll talk about at the end of this video. Suffice to say that I don't have a problem with the way Phoenix is portrayed here, so much as I have with him being portrayed differently later on. Trucy is a fun sidekick character to Apollo, and I don't care who says otherwise. I like how they kind of made fun of the fact that she's replacing Maya by making Trucy a magic user, but of a different kind. Don't get me wrong, I hope she's not a permanent replacement. Although, when the most we see of future Maya so far is one letter from her in Dual Destinies, it's hard not to assume that. But I will say one thing. She's a well-developed character, and that scene where Phoenix first adopts her gets me every time. Although, I do hope Phoenix tells them that they're related pretty fast, otherwise we might get some Luke and Leia sexual tension there. Ugh. You know, in any other series, this idea would not make sense. A prosecutor by day and a rock star by night. And yet, Clavier fits right in as far as I'm concerned. I've heard this description used before, but Clavier is like one of those D&D characters who put all of his skill points into charisma. Well, okay, that's not fair to say. He says that he became a musician so girls would turn their heads when he walks down the street. But he says that that's because he likes to keep things simple. He takes his job seriously as a prosecutor and as a rock star and performs them to the best of his ability. But he rarely lets the stress get to him. So it's actually even more satisfying when Apollo manages to shake that confidence. Speaking of Apollo, you may have noticed during the retrospective that Clavier speaks with a German accent, with the addition of calling Apollo Herr Vorhead, or Trucy Fräulein, or what seems to be his catchphrase, Achtung, baby. Kind of reminds me of Wonka's Au revoir, baby, from Okami. But here's the thing, Clavier isn't German. He just studied abroad in Europe for a few years and picked up the accent as part of his Euro-rocker persona. And he still completely pulls it off. He knows how important one's image is in the court and out of it, and knows how to maintain it. He embraced his stage persona fully, and I think that's why almost everyone I know likes him, even if it isn't how he originally acted. And you get the feeling that because of that, it's easy to fool people into thinking he knows less than he does. Several times throughout the game, Apollo realizes too late that Clavier was one step ahead of him the whole time. And let's be honest, it'd take a lot of guts to help your brother get convicted of murder. And last but not least, there's Emma. Now an older detective, Emma seems to have a more aggressive personality, but I actually kind of like that. It shows that she was able to overcome her past demons. They try to give her a running gag of always eating these snacks when she's at a crime scene, but I don't think it did anything for her. Mainly her biggest inspiration for getting into crime fighting was Phoenix, and she wants to see him again to thank him for all he did for her, but that begs the question of why Phoenix never goes to see her. I mean, yeah, at first she was being an annoying obstacle to Apollo and Trucy, but come on, the least you could have done was talk to her yourself. I think that would have made for a really emotional scene. That being said, despite failing the test, she still knows more about forensics than anyone else in the series, so I think she's doing something right. Some people say that Apollo Justice is the worst game in the series. Do I agree with that? Hell no, you knew that already. But the question becomes harder when you ask me if I think it's a bad game. No, I don't think it is. But I do think that some of this game's greatest victories might be some of its greatest failures, too. This game, by its own admission, is a game about passing the torch to the next generation. Apollo was probably meant to become the new star of the series, but from what I can tell, there was a bad reaction to how they had to strip Phoenix of his job to do so. I can understand that, though it feels kind of like a damned if you do, damned if you don't situation. People hate Apollo because he's not Phoenix, but they also hate him because he's too much like Phoenix. You can see the creator's dilemma here. And then there's the matter of this game's ending. The establishment of the jurist system reflects the idea that the justice system is evolving. In short, if there were another Ace Attorney game that took place directly after this one, I'm pretty sure that it would be a lot less involved with the jury and the police actually doing their jobs. But more than that, it feels like this game would have been a logical place to put the endpoint of the series at. Sure, there's the matter of Thalassa being reunited with her kids, because at the end it said that her memories are returning, but at the most, there might be one game's worth of story material after this because Apollo might be out of a job due to the presence of the jury. And if that was the case, the only logical way they can make more games for the series would be to go backwards in time. Which they did. Ace Attorney Investigations takes place in the modern day when Apollo took place in the future, and the upcoming Great Ace Attorney takes place in the distant past. But the creators, or Capcom 1, didn't want to put an endpoint on the series, so Dual Destinies would be a return to formula. The jurist system wouldn't work out and there'd be a new Dark Age of the Law, where so many false testimonies and evidence show up that Phoenix would have to step in along with Apollo and a new disciple. And fair enough, if the game is still making you money and you don't want to put an endpoint on the story, don't let me stop you. But it kind of makes the ending of this game seem hollow. Not to mention, Phoenix acts more like how he was in the original series in Dual Destinies, so that chess master persona seems to have vanished. Admittedly, Phoenix is facing a pretty intimidating foe at times, but he doesn't seem to have as many years of planning as this version of Phoenix had. And Dual Destinies didn't provide any closure to Apollo's story. And damn it, I want Thalassa to see her kids again! All that said, you might think I'm crazy when I say that Dual Destinies is my favorite game in the Ace Attorney series, but I stand by that. On its own, it's fantastic. It just invalidates a lot of what Apollo Justice set up. That, I think, is the biggest problem with Apollo Justice. This feels like the end of the series, but it wasn't. And because of that, the execution feels a little botched. And I've been reviewing TV shows for some time now. I know how badly this can go. When a show is demanding to end, but the creators force it to keep going, it can end up destroying the show. But as far as I'm concerned, Capcom hasn't done that with Ace Attorney. I've liked every game that came out after Apollo Justice. Hell, two of my favorite games in the series came out after it. So, I don't know. I think that the Ace Attorney series still has a lot of steam left in it. It's just a pity that poor Apollo had to suffer for it. But in the next video, we're handing off the reins to another new protagonist, but this time it's one we've met before. Join me next time as I take a look at Ace Attorney Investigations.
I'd like to see you out one night, dressed up like a rock and roll star. Straight out of some strange magazine, then I know I love you. But if I see you out somewhere, you might think that I don't care. Up like a race car driver. You push the engine all the way, then I know I love you. But if I see you out somewhere, you might think that I don't care. If I love my guitar, I love my guitar. We always stay up late at night, up in my a teenage porn star. Straight out of late night in great trash, then I know I love you. But if I see you out somewhere, you might think that I don't care. I love my guitar, I love my guitar.
We always stay up late at night, up in my
trial is yours!